started? Yeah, how's everybody's weekend?
Great.
Paul?
I was just seeing kind of retina patients.
But not on call.
Oh, yeah.
But on the retina rotation, you do that on Saturdays.
What did you say?
On the retina rotation, are you seeing?
Well, the fellows were gone, so I had to come see testing post-ops, and then there's like a bad endophthalmitis that was kind of following up on.
Both of the fellows are gone?
Yeah. I think they're, well, no, they got permission, but they're, one of James is back.
The, Chris and I were at the meeting in San Diego this morning.
Yeah.
It's great. A killer job this past year.
Steal that poster and answer questions like it was my job.
People walked away with this like stud look. You know,
take pictures, sign an autograph.
It's big time. We'll jump into this lecture. There's part of the lecture from last time that I gave you guys. If we have time to, we can do it again. But, So I was charged with doing esotropias and exotropias, and I really want to just focus on the basics. I feel like I didn't really understand this until I was a fellow, that's why I haven't sat through this lecture multiple times as a resident. So it's going to be, again, very interactive. Please kind of guess and feel free to get it wrong. I just think it's just too painful to talk about it multiple times. So, first case, what do you guys think? What do you see?
Pseudo esotropia.
Why would you say pseudo?
Because the light reflex is symmetrically centered. So
yeah.
Larger.
So you look at the corneal light reflex right there, and it is dead center. This is a pretty tough one though, right? But for all intents and purposes, that looks crossed. And so you see why we get so many referrals for kids. That ended up being pseudo-ET, because it's not easy to tell. And I'll tell you, this kid has all the features that we look for in trying to differentiate. First thing is what we call this prominent epicanthal folds. You can just tell that right, the skin really covers over the inside of the conjunctiva. So when you can't see that medial conjunctiva, it looks crossed. And one of the reasons that the skin kind of pours over the inside of the eye is to that flat nasal bridge right there. So you look at an adult from a side profile, and the nose, you know, dips in a little bit, but not that much, but a kid, the nose dips way in and comes out. So often to show the parents, because I don't want to give the parents a complex that their kid's going to look funny when they grow older, that they have something wrong with their face. So I say, I'll tell them the flat part of their nose is going to grow and pull that skin up and in, and they'll look totally normal. I'll grab the kid, and I'll grab the skin right here and pull it in, and they'll look normal. And if the kid will let me, the parents are like, oh, phew. So like we said, you cover up the medial conjunctiva, and then kids, the other kind of group of kids, in addition to all these things, is when kids' eyes are just close together, they look crossed. This is true of adults, too, where if you have a short interpupillary distance, don't be fooled by that. And measure it, and you think, you see like in the 50s or for an adult, or low 50s or high 40s for a kid, then you kind of realize maybe that's what makes them look crossed. And then the most important thing is the corneal light reflex and doing ultimate cover. I had a mentor who told me every time I diagnose pseudo-ET, I have them follow up in a year. And I think that's there's just a great principle there when you think this is nothing, just to always be sure. Because or even 6 months, and I had this just a few months ago, the son of a pediatric neurosurgery fellow, you guys are going to be interacting with him, had what I thought was pseudo-ET, but I wasn't quite sure. And so I asked him to come back in 3 months, and I gave him my email address and said, send me pictures if you feel like this is wrong, and you feel like it's different, but right now it doesn't look cross. And then 2 months later, or 3 months later, I saw him again, it was crossed. The child at the time didn't have really good fixation, and I couldn't do a good alternate cover testing, and I missed it the first time. So it happens. And so not missing it is not an ideal that you can strive to all the time. I think you have to just put checks in there that allow you to miss things, But then if when it happens, you're still gonna catch it later. So, pseudo ET or real ET?
Real.
Yeah. So, this is, I feel like whenever we talk about ETs and XTs, people just throw up the type of ET or a type of XT and then give you a big bullet point of all the things that it is. And I want to kind of approach this for this case. This kid comes to your clinic, what is your thought process? So we're going to kind of, this lecture is going to be more clinical than just like categorized by diagnosis. So 18-month-old comes in, the mom tells you that they've been, their eyes have been crossing for about 3 months intermittently. What's on your differential, and what are the most important questions you want to try to figure out in clinic? Go ahead.
Like a cranial nerve palsy would be that. Which is unlikely, but it treats a nodal six nerve palsy.
Yeah, yeah. Most worrisome, least likely. And I want to, because I feel like also as a resident, I didn't have any sense of what's most likely versus least likely. And so we'll try to cut through that too. So if you always hear about six nerve palsy. It turns out in kids, they're very rare. Especially isolated from anything else. You know, the kid's not, you're going to get, you know, the brain tumor or neurological signs, you know. What else would be on the differential? But you're exactly right. You have to check abduction every time, nonetheless.
Refractive error.
Yeah. Anything else on your differential?
A sensory ET.
Sensory ET, totally.
Duane.
Perfect. I think with refractive, and the other one is accommodated ET, maybe that's what you're kind of, there's a little lack there. What's the one, so if a kid comes in your clinic and they've been crossing intermittently or constant around this age, what's the one thing that you care most about in finding in that first exam?
Refractive error.
Prescription. Is this kid hyperopic? So that's the first, so whenever you see a kid who's crossing, your first question is this kid hyperopic? The most common type of crossing is accommodated ET. So your very first question, so every kid who comes from crossing, you just, I mean, from the minute you look at him, you just say, well, I'll measure this, but what I really care about is this kid farsighted or not? Even if they're amblyopic, that's a secondary question, because if they're farsighted, you just can put them in glasses. So that kiddo, straight right out from glasses. So let me talk about accommodated ET real quick. And again, this is most common of all the ETs. And this gets questioned on the boards much more commonly than these like nystagmus blockade ET. All these weird entities you read about and you feel like, don't even know that. So I want to really make sure you this is kind of drilled home. So accommodated ET, the range is 4 months to 7 years of age, meaning anyone who comes in crossing, you're going to consider putting in glasses. What do you think would be is there a cutoff you guys know of for how much hyperopia you'd be willing to put try out glasses on versus when you say, you know what, there's no way this is accommodative.
It was like less than two, maybe.
Two's a good number. Most people say three, and that's kind of like what's in the books, the textbooks. Like there's more than three. I think if they're crossing and they've got 2 or 250, depending on how it looks, I often try on glasses too. You'd hate to do surgery on something you could have fixed with glasses. And then if you do surgery, and then they end up being farsighted, you have to put them in glasses. They'll go XT in glasses. Because then you can relax their focusing. Yes. I think two is the number probably that was, I think it's most wise. So interesting thing. It's often intermittent, especially when it first starts. So when parents describe this intermittent crossing, really commonly accommodated ET. If there's a family history of it, it's one of the most common strabismus entities that runs in families. And this would raise, to your point, Reese, is this a six nerve palsy? You'll see these in the ER not uncommonly. Kid comes in, gets really sick, or has a bad cold, or just something happens, and then eye starts crossing. And everybody is, there's no way you'll stop the CT scan on that child. They'll just do it, which is probably not a bad thing, but if I went to the ER, kid who was just had like a bad cold, had sudden crossing, and I checked his prescription +4, I would push back against getting imaging, because he's healthy otherwise. This is a carotid T that just came out because it was kind of a tenuous hole on the straight eyes that just broke. Anyone give me a line for why uncorrected hyperopia can cause crossing? How would you try to explain this to a family? Or to a group of residents?
Chris? So when we are accommodating, our pupils constrict, and our eyes sort of turn in. And so if you're having to accommodate just to see what we see at a normal distance, that's going to happen. The pupils are going to constrict, the eyes are going to turn in the attempt to focus like we do when we read up close.
Yeah, great job, Chris. The near triad is kind of what you refer to, right?
Yeah.
The accommodation, pupil constriction, and convergence. In the brain, they're just married to each other. You can't divorce them. This is a term that they throw around, insufficient fugital divergence. I feel like strabismologists love these like really complex terms, and they kind of just make it hard to grasp the field. So don't be thrown off by this stuff. Just can't keep your eyes straight and focus. So again, that same case presentation, when you put the glasses in, you don't know if it's accommodated ET until you've given them time in the glasses. So again, kind of personally, clinically, I tell parents one of two things will happen. It's either not going to get better, it'll partially get better, or this will just get rid of the crossing altogether. And you don't really know yet until you have to come back in 3 months or 2 months, whatever you want. So occasionally they'll be straight at distance, but then they'll continue to cross at near. And those are the kids who you consider having this high accommodative convergence to accommodation ratio. And I don't actually think out of kids I ever had to mathematically calculate that. And that means that you probably will, because it's just Murphy's Law. But I feel like this is way overcomplicated. And again, I don't want to, if I went over the math right now, you probably would forget it anyway by OCAPS. So I just want you to get the principle, and that is, so in your brain, so these two are kind of, again, they're married, right? Accommodation and crossing. And we're focusing and crossing. And it just turns out that the brain has an imbalance between the two. So the amount of focusing that the brain does, it just drives too much convergence. And the whole goal of these kids is to get their eyes straight so that they can get that sensory motor fusion that we talked about last time. So let's go through a bunch of cases here. First case, and maybe we'll just bounce around the room. We can like go like from one side to the other. So we'll do a handful of cases. So starting with Lee, +4, ET is 30. So and you guys know what does the apostrophe mean?
Near.
Near, yeah. So crossing of 30 distance near 30 as well. They're +4, and these are all 18 months old, new patient exam. What are you gonna do, Lee? So sorry, you already know the prescription is +4. So what's your management plan?
Just to continue to follow, I guess.
And you haven't done anything yet. You haven't put on glasses. You haven't done. So is this a kid you put in glasses or not?
It looks like it's concomitant. So I mean, I don't know if I would put in glasses just yet, just because. It may be related to some other issue. I don't know.
So this is why I'm glad to have these numbers up here. Don't be thrown off by the fact that it's crossing a distance and near. Mm-hmm. This still very well could be accommodative.
Okay.
But again, you're touching on, I don't know what this is. So do I watch them out of glasses or in glasses? Well, how will you know if it's accommodative?
Well, you test them, you see if there's an actual greater mesotropia when they actually do a near versus distance.
So, so, uh, turns out, in theory, that makes sense. That's not how it actually translates to clinical practice. So the way to know if this is accommodated is you put them in glasses. Almost regardless of the difference between these two. Confusing, but I'm trying to simplify this because I feel like the theory of cognitive ET is, you're right, you can see, maybe you see some more crossing at near than the distance would suggest, you know, a cognitive ET. And in this case, and you haven't done PC, so you're demonstrating some good kind of sound thinking of understanding this principle, but if they're crossing at all and they're more than plus two, glasses, and even if they have limited abduction, I'd still work with glasses. Because you need to see what happens.
Given the full cephalic refraction.
Any Bob?
That was too nasally.
Yeah. So you put them in glasses, they come back for ortho near distance. Really common. So let's do another case. Ashley, go ahead. So what do you do with this one? So this is kind of what he's talking about. You're crossing more and near a distance. Are you going to do something different this time?
No.
Why not?
Because I just want to see what they do with the plus fours first.
Cool. Oh, sorry. Those thumbs up there. You put it in plus four, same thing happens. So again, don't get caught up in you know, is it greater distance or near? If a kid comes in crossing, sometimes I feel like I don't even need to measure this. So hyperopic, I'm going to put my glasses, I'll bring it back, and then I'll measure it, because then I'll see what it is. So, exactly. And then remind me of your name, I'm still learning.
I'm Lindsay.
Lindsay, okay. Mm-hmm. Lindsay, so what would you do in this third case?
I would start with the cycloplegic refraction initially, and then have them back.
So, you come back, and then these are the measurements now. Mm-hmm. So this gets a little more tricky, Lindsay, but if they're ET, so in their glasses, they're now 20 at distance and 35 at near. Mm-hmm. What are you going to do now? Your options are, so redilate and check the prescription one more time, put them in bifocals, or do strabismus surgery.
I might redilate, recycle plegia, make sure I got the full, they're not like a plus five. And then I would try bifocals.
So the for boards and OCAPs, you're exactly right. Whenever you see this, the first answer is redilate. Because OCAPs and boards want you to be surgically conservative. And just conservative in general. Like every answer that's like, if you can get away with watching observations, you should be the right answer. It turns out though, so let's say they come back and they're still this, no change. Would you do bifocals or surgery?
How old are they?
They're two.
Two. I would send them for a surgical eval.
Surgery would be appropriate here. Because they're two, they're in this sensitive developmental stage developmental age of vision. And you want to get this kid straight as soon as possible so that they can recapture that sensory fusion and get back stereopsis and other things that you benefit from having straight eyes. You don't want to sit around with one of these. If they're not straight, you've got the full prescription on. And then to contrast that with this one,
how much surgery would you do on that kid for case three? Like, would you treat?
You do, so kids who have accommodated ET, you always err towards doing more surgery.
To treat the 30.
You do probably 35, because they'll eat it up. Some people go for the longer, the higher number, and then they add another milliliter of recession to recession. So we'll jump to this case, because you put them in glasses. Go ahead. Well, so what are you going to do with their ortho at distance and ET of 20?
Probably put them in bifocal.
So why would a bifocal be the right answer here, you're right, and the wrong answer here? Because there's crossing greater at near than there is at distance.
Because they're tropping at a distance, and so you need to help that. So it looks like it's still accommodated, so when they're accommodating, they're going across, and the bifocal will help relax that.
Perfect. So this is, and bifocals are so commonly misunderstood. If the kid's not ortho at distance and they're not fusing at distance, like you could do a worth 4-dot test at distance, you want to make sure this kid has sensory fusion ability, and I can see the two eyes are working together at distance, but they're not at near. That's the child who's going to benefit from bifocals. If you put up the worth 4-dot test and then at distance, and they're suppressing one eye, even though their eyes look straight, and they're just not fusing, and you with plus threes over, they have no stereo, who cares if this kid's crossing near? It's not going to be cosmetic. So you don't need to put every kid in bifocal who crosses more in the air than they do in distance. And you don't even need to put every kid who's ortho distance in ET of 20 in bifocal, just the ones who you feel like have potential for sensory fusion. At this age, you can't do a lot of those sensory tests, so you're going to do it on most kids. But bifocals are typically overprescribed for kids, you would never want to do it in this case because they're not fusing in the distance. So bifocals are it's not going to do anything. They're not even close. They have to be fusing in the distance and have fusional potential in the air that you can get in the bifocal. So great, perfect, spot on.
So if they don't have fusional potential,
in what example would that be?
Let's say you had a congenital ET kid, so they're crossing from birth. These kids, their eyes don't work together. They don't have binocular fusion, almost period. So you can do strabismus surgery, straighten that kid out. Let's say you did surgery and they got to be ortho at distance. But you can tell with all these tests that whenever they're looking in the distance, they're just switching between the two eyes. They're not using both eyes together. They have monofixation, and then you measure them up near and they're still crossing.
Why
put them in bifocal? No. When he's looking up here, so I can kind of voluntarily cross my eyes. So I'm crossing my eyes now. Can you tell that I'm crossing my eyes, or does it just look like I'm looking at my hand still?
It just looks like you're looking at your hand.
Yeah, you can't tell, right? My hand's like double, like one hand here, one hand here. I'm crossing quite a bit, but you just can't tell. So there is a big part of strabismus surgery that's cosmetic to help these kids function normally in their social life.
So like a 2-year-old, though, like with a bifocal, are they going to really use the, like,
Give me executive time.
So the answer is yes, if you selected the kid appropriately.
Okay.
So why does a kid walk around with a tilted head when they have fourth grade palsy? Why do they just suppress one eye?
Because they're fusing.
Because they want to fuse. Yeah. There is a powerful drive to fuse if you can. So why does a kid who's plus 5 who you know for all intents and purposes can't see clearly unless he kicks in all that accommodation and crosses his eyes, why would he be intermittently cross? Why? Because when his eyes are straight, you know that he's not focusing, right? It's because the brain cares so much about both eyes being straight and trying to fuse. So much so that it would actually not even accommodate the full amount to get a clear picture just to keep the eyes straight. So you'll see kids you'll know when you selected appropriately a kid to put in bifocals, because when you show them something near, they sneak their chin up to look through the bifocal, just instantly. And they'll do that on their own. And the kids are smart enough that you don't even have to like train them and tell parents that that's what they need to do. They'll just do it. And not that many kids actually need bifocals, because most of them will just look, you put them in bifocal, they come in and they chin down to look at the near card over the bifocal, then it's probably something you need it. In particular cases, it's very helpful. Again, an office over you. So, 5-month-old baby, certainly real crossing. Looking at this, how would you describe this, that this is all you saw? What do you learn about this picture? What do you learn from this picture? I think maybe since you're out
loud. They're fixating with their left eye at this moment.
Nice.
And
so
it's a large angle.
So it's, perfect. Large angle, maybe some amblyopia in the right eye. How would you find out if they had amblyopia in the right eye? This is a 5-month-old baby.
I'd cover their left eye and see if they cry.
I'm trying to flick them as you do it, right? Yeah. So cover their left eye, and then the other way, not just to see if they cry, but if you cover their left eye, so if you cover their left eye, and then you hope that this eye's gonna go whoop and look straight at you, right?
Yeah.
And then as I come off, I watch how long they hold with that eye. That makes, that's the whole maintain thing, right, on the CSM. So if they maintain that eye, I'm like, oh, this is just an alternate fixator, right? If you had to guess what entity of ET this is?
Congenital.
Probably congenital at this age. Congenital is really large angle, and you see it from a really young age. So let's put them in glasses. These kids' eyes straight in glasses. No. So you still approach it because, if you remember, what was the earliest age that we see accommodated ET? Do you remember that range?
4 months.
4 months. So if you have one kid who looks like congenital ET for all intents and purposes, but they're plus 5, you're still going to put them in glasses. I had a little girl who was plus 6, plus 650, who was 2, and I put in glasses. But mom said she'd been crossing since she was like 2 months old, and her eyes didn't do anything. So I cycled through her eyes, essentially I aspirinized her eyes so that she would have to have the glasses to see well, right? Because she wouldn't wear the glasses, the full cycle of refraction. So even aspirinized, she gradually took on the glasses, still had the exact same like 60 diopters of ET. So you still go through that process clinically. It's not always like obviously congenital ET or obviously congenital ET from the get-go. So congenital ET, you see it, there's a number of terms again that get thrown around. Ocular instability of infancy. That kind of is derived from the pathogenesis. That they feel like there's a, I don't know exactly know what causes this, but the fusion center of the brain that helps the two eyes lock together is defective. And the reason people feel like this is because even when you fix these kids, even at a young age, they often have subnormal fusion, stereopsis, and all those tests, the worst four-dot test, seem like they're suppressing a lot. Can they not fuse and therefore they cross, or is it motor development? Do they come out cross and therefore they can't fuse because it was such an early crossing and they missed that, again, that critical window? We don't know. Do these kids tend to have amblyopia?
Yes.
Yes. What is one of the things or the tricks that they use that often prevents amblyopia in these kids? Because I would say these kids do have amblyopia, you do see it a fair amount, but probably less than accommodated ET. They do something where they switch. Do you remember what that term is called? It's cross fixation. So these kids, so if their head's this way and you're on this side, they look at you with that eye, and then if something happens over here, they just switch to looking at that eye. So they've got these eyes that are just like surveying the opposite worlds at all times.
of course.
And they just switch. You don't really know what they're looking at often. So, do you guys know what we often see in conjunction with congenital ET? There's other findings that come out as these kids grow up. Any guesses?
Latent nystagmus.
Latent nystagmus, perfect. So when you're working a kid up and they're plus 5, crossing sense a little bit, now they're 2, you curl one eye and also you see an eye jiggle, and all of a sudden you're thinking, I mean, this isn't accommodated, maybe this is congenital ET. So that's where that stuff kind of comes in handy too. Anything else?
DVD.
DVD. And you have to see if you're oblique overaction too. You see that in accommodated ET also, but more common than this.
Dissociative
reticular deviation. Yeah, Chris, I'm having to explain if you don't know what DVD is, because I don't know, this is probably that long, so I'll even tell you that. So what happens is you cover one eye, and the eye that's getting covered up, if you had a see-through glass, that eye that's covered up goes whoop, starts floating up. And it breaks, I'm struggling with these two glass. Herring's or Sherrington's, you guys remember?
Herring's.
Herring, I think it breaks Herring's. Herring's is the one that the yolk muscle always works right. So one superior rectus fires, the other superior rectus fires. One eye actually does its own thing. And that's the only times you see that long eyelid. So treatment for these kids is surgery. And these kids get an average of 3 surgeries over the first 10 years because it's just a very unstable alignment. It keeps coming back, or the DVD comes out, kind of more commonly as they get older, but you have to, you want to fix it before they're at 2 to try to improve fusion. So here's kind of, I feel like as you read that chapter of BCSC, all these, I just want to use distracting type ETs because they're just all so much less common. Cyclic ET, I've never seen this. Cyanse syndrome, it's just like just an extreme form of congenital ET. So they have nice damage and they look out, maybe retinitis are really tight. Sensory ET, one eye doesn't see well. So does anyone know when you see sensory ET versus sensory XT? Because I bet in the adult world, the sensory eyes, what's more common, the ET or the XT?
XT.
Yeah, so the difference is, I have no idea why. When an eye doesn't see well and they're younger than 5, it tends to turn in. When they're older than 5, it tends to turn out. So in the adult world, you almost always see sensory XT, but in the early kind of peep land, you see a lot of sensory ET. Divergence insufficiency, so what are the measurements? Are they, do you see an ET greater at near or distance? When will the ET be greater, do you think, for divergence insufficiency?
Distance.
Yeah. So if you see it, if a kid has elevated ICP or brain tumor, what are you worried about? Bilateral 6 neuropathy. So you don't want to mix up divergent insufficiency for bilateral 6 that you can get from elevated ICP, because they can't add depth, right? So most 6 nerve palsies are greater distance than they are here. Nystagmus blockage syndrome, it turns out the neural point is when they converge. So anyway, don't get too caught in those things. We're going to jump into exotropias now. Does anyone sense a theme going on here?
Balance.
I like that. Balance, yes, that's very yin and yang. Tall and short happen to be
opposite.
So, yes. But it seems like the most obvious questions have like the most delayed response. So, it can't be that simple. Anyway, so a lot of people think that exotropia is just equal and opposite to esotropia, that there's some, it's like balance. Turns out they're not at all similar. So so this is what like did me in for a long time. It's like, oh, so myopes maybe have like this XT maybe correct, or I was thinking all incorrectly about this, it's just totally different. So we're gonna talk about intermittent exotropia here for a second. Intermittent exotropia, an eye that kind of occasionally wanders out. There's two questions, there's a couple of questions that really, really matter when you manage this. What are those questions? Any guesses?
Like what percent of the time that they're crossing?
Exactly. What are you trying to determine with that question? Whether or not you'll do what?
Surgery.
Yeah. Surgery is how often it's happening. Any other questions come to mind? This kind of captures the same thing. How often does the eye go out? How long does it stay out for? Almost every parent can kind of capture that. And a lot of them say, oh, it goes out all the time. And they say, how long does it stay out for? And they say, like, 3 seconds. Is that a kid you should do surgery on? Just snaps out, snaps back, like, every hour? No, that just sounds like pretty good control. So these two questions, I feel like, really capture what you're looking for. In clinic, we actually gauge control. So intermittent XT, this is a new principle that you don't see in a common ET. Kids with ET don't control their crossing, but kids with intermittent XT, the way I explain this to parents is the eyes are out when they're relaxed, but the brain wants them straight. So it's a tug of war. What we're trying to figure out is who's winning that tug of war, and how can we help your brain win out to keep the eyes straight? And if the brain can't win out, then we have to go and change the anatomy. Because otherwise, the relaxed anatomy is just pulling those eyes down. So, let's say a kid has 15 diopters of intermittent XT, and another kid has 50 prism diopters of intermittent XT. Are you more likely to do surgery on one of those, or what does that matter? in your surgical decision making.
It doesn't matter as long as they have good control.
Yeah, perfect, actually. It determines how much surgery you do, not whether or not to do surgery. Yeah, perfect. Would you think that this breaks down at distance or at near more often, the end of an XT? So what are you going to see this, when the kid's reading or when the kid's looking out the car window?
Looking out the car window.
Yeah, so almost a little counterintuitive, right? Because if the eyes are out and they're doing something up close, that's a whole bunch of convergence. But for some reason, we see this way more at distance. So let's see if this video works. This video, I feel like, captures intermittent XT. We're going to watch it just a couple of times here. So watch your eyes. She's straight. What just happened there?
She went out.
Which eye went out first?
Left eye.
The one that I was covering. And then what happened when I uncovered it?
It snapped back.
The left eye snapped back, but then what did the right eye do? It went out. So what do you know about this child's fixing eye?
Left eye.
It's her left eye. Just putting my hand in front of her face, though, for 3 seconds when she's looking at the distance was enough to break down her fusion, so her eyes went to a relaxed state. And then when I uncovered, they didn't snap back, so her control is actually poor. That makes sense? So this is what poor control looks like. She's straight. I just go whoop, interrupt fusion. So once I interrupt fusion, the brain doesn't have two pictures to lock together. So one picture disappears, so that eye just goes to where it's resting. But then when I uncovered, she said, well, you know what, I actually prefer my left eye, so she switches to her left eye. And her right eye stays out. So what happens when I have her look at a near target without doing anything? So I had to just switch her look at distance to near. What happened?
She brought it together.
She brought it together just fine on her own, right? For the control at near is always stronger than that at distance. And then watch, I'm gonna, so watch when I, so I'm gonna do the same thing, I'm gonna, at near, I'm gonna uncover her eye and watch what happens. What happened? Do you see that? It was subtle. The eye was out, but is she straight or is she out now? So I covered it and I uncovered it and really quickly just goes whoop, it went right back to being straight to looking at the target. So what's her control at near? Fair, poor, or good? Good, yeah, because the minute I uncovered it, before she even blinked, that eye came back and straightened out. So what happened there?
It started to go out, and then she scratched her head. She focused on her finger, and it came back in.
Wasn't that interesting?
Yeah.
She just like she like, kind of just like played with her, like her eyebrow or something, and then she fixed her control. So the second time around, Would you quantify that as fair, you know, was it poor, fair, or good control?
Fair.
At distance, it was fair. It stayed out for a few seconds and then came back. People often use a blink as the determination of, you know, separating good and poor. So if the eye stays out and they blink and it comes in, then you say it's either fair or good. If they blink and it stays out, then it's usually poor. So it's a pretty interesting case, though. That I feel like captures all the things we need to know about intermittent XT. So this is a busy slide, so let's just like cut this down. This is the four phases of intermittent XT. The way this often starts, what's the X without anything else? What does that stand for? Exophoria, which means what? Will you see this? Like, these kids walk around with their eye and jerk out? No. So you, often with these kids, you measure it. They have a little foveal at distance, but they're ortho at near. And then 6 months later, they've got an intermittent that mom sees when the kid is looking out the car window. For some reason, that's when it always comes out. When they're in their car seat, looking at the car window, right before bedtime when they're naps or when they're sick. All the times where you've got your anatomy and then your neuro trying to just tug where to keep your eyes. Whether if there's anything that's making your brain not fire in all six cylinders, then your anatomy wins out, the eyes go in the resting place. So if you're tired, sick, or just daydreaming. So then what happens is, so you get this intermittent XT, and then it near you have this mild exophoria. And they're often distant, different. Like you'll get a 30 XT, 30 intermittent XT at distance, and then something really small in the air. And then they go manifest at distance, and then intermittent at near, and then they go manifest at both. So this is just the progression if you watch most of these kids, what happens. When do you think would be the optimal time to intervene with surgery? Stage 1, 2, 3, or 4?
3.
Yeah, I'd say somewhere between 2 and 3. Yeah, so you certainly don't operate here. You don't have to operate here, because they're still fusing it near. They're still using their eyes together enough that they often aren't losing stereopsis and other things. Here's where they start kind of falling apart. And actually, you kind of let, in here, you just let parents guide you on when it bothers them, if it's affecting the child. So based on that, do you think control worsens or improves with age?
Worsens.
Yeah, exactly, just like that progression. Some remain stable and a few improve, hence why it's good to watch this for a little bit, because they do get that exception. So we already talked about that. Is amblyopia common with intermittent XT? No, it's not.
Does it worsen with age just because they start having monofixation, or?
So you don't see monofixation in this. So that's a great question. Monofixation is when, again, they're still suppressing, even though their eyes are pretty close to being straight. See it a lot with congenital AT and certain accommodative ETs, but they have subnormal stereopsis, and so they don't fuse very well, so they suppress one eye, at least centrally, and they can fuse peripherally. Intermittent XT, these kids have great stereo most of the time. Their eyes lock together really well, it's just they just get tired and their eyes drift back out. And for some reason, their ability for them to overcome the resting state of the eye's alignment just decreases with age. I'm not sure why.
So they don't suppress at all?
Usually, they suppress when the eye goes out,
okay.
But that's it. A great story, so when the eye goes out though, sometimes they actually will have, they won't suppress entirely the peripheral vision of that eye that goes out. So these guys will have like wicked peripheral vision. And there was an NFL lineman who went and saw one of my mentors with this huge intermittent XT, and said, I want this fixed, and they fixed it, and he came back and he says, I can no longer see the receiver running on my left side. It's just like really affecting you. Can you undo it? Isn't that crazy? For the Colts. True story. So let's go through some cases again. I think we were at Chris. 2-year-old with intermittent XT of 40 at distance and 20 at near, with good control for both. What do you do? You're in the old movie Speed. Sorry. Keanu Reeves, another one of his very pale performances. It just seems real light in place. Alright, good control for both. What do you do, Chris?
Surgery.
I knew it. So zealous. No, you do not want to touch his finger or the eye. So, good control. You can watch this as long as you want, so long as there's good control. I'm just teasing Chris, sorry. It's a great answer. So what you want to do is, if they're controlling it, there's no rush here. Are you surprised that it's larger distance than it is in the air?
No.
Based on that progression I told you, this is what we expect, right? So I'm gonna check the vision, I'm gonna just double check there's no amblyopia and the refractive. What if this kid was -2? Would you put him in glasses?
Yeah.
So how easy do you think it is for your brain to fuse two blurry images versus two clear images at distance?
Probably harder.
Yeah, it's a lot harder. So if this kid's a myo, it's gonna help them fuse. That has nothing to do with the combination or that way it affects. It's just going to give them clear pictures to lock together. So this kid you're going to monitor. Maybe put in glasses. Does that make sense? So it's good control. Don't touch it. Remind me one more time.
Becca.
The interns I said, I'm getting to you guys. Becca, thank you.
So they're like -2, what would you give them?
So the question is, do I over minus them? Because if I give them like a -3, then they have to do a little bit of accommodation, and accommodations and convergence are tied. So that's the whole theory of over minusing. Is that what you're getting at, Reese? Mm-hmm. So some so big debate on whether we over-minus these kids, force them to accommodate, which will help kind of bring their eyes together. If they're already myopic, I have to do over-minus them by anywhere from like 50 to a diopter. One study showed that it didn't really have any huge long-term benefit. At the end of the day, if you're really over-minusing them and holding their control that way, that's not a long-term solution, because they're gonna start getting astigmatopia and just eye strain from focusing as they get older. You can't do that forever. You're not changing their anatomy. So I usually do a little bit of over-minusing if they're already a myope, and then just watch it. Becca, go ahead.
So in this case, it's a little bit older child, and they're having fair control with the kids, still good control with me. I don't know, I might still watch, try glasses.
You're spot on with the kind of the head bobble.
Yeah.
our hands aren't tied here, are they? Accommodating VT, if that kid's crossing, and they're either not focusing or they're crossing, they're going to develop amblyopia. We can't watch that. We have to put them in glasses, and if it's a show crossing, we need to fix it. Not the case here. I ask the parents, what do you want to do? I tell them, we don't have to do surgery right now. This is probably likely to get worse with time. It's a little bit of a question of, do we fix it now or later, but some cases do improve. Go ahead.
This is kind of the age where maybe kids start making fun of.
Seven happens to be kind of the magic number, but 5-year-olds are still sweet. So, no, you're right. You're exactly right. Do I fix it now to prevent that from happening so they don't get labeled by their peers when they get to the kind of the mean age? Isn't that sad? 7 to 8 when kids like start like. Like a 5-year-old doesn't notice skin color differences, like appearance differences. They tend to not pay attention to these things nearly as much as like a second grader.
Hmm.
So maybe they kind of start picking this up. So yeah. So I have a lot of parents who tell me I don't want to have to deal with this as they get into that stage of childhood, which is like, this is ruthless. So let's fix this now. If they do have surgery, you have to do it. So again, you do a full workup. Maybe if they're myopic, then I'm certainly not going to do surgery. I'm going to put in glasses and have more time. How much would you operate for, do you think?
40.
Yeah, about 40. Nobody agreed on this. So you're not going to ask, I don't guess. All right. Tara, what do you think? Kids are poor control distance but totally ortho in the air. If you're gonna operate, how much are you gonna operate for? That's a big difference, right?
Yeah.
40 and 0.
Less than 40.
So this is where intermittent XT gets lost on everybody. It's because this is like that whole like, I forget the terms, I don't even pay attention to them anymore. There's like tenacious proximal fusion and is this like true divergence excess? Because it just gets so messy here, and almost none of it's clinically relevant. What you're gonna do here is you're gonna prolong their occlusion, because these kids do have a strong drive to fuse it near. So what you do is you put a patch on, or you cover their eye for an extended period of time, and then remeasure it near without ever uncovering both eyes. So the patch can't come off before you check them in near, and then you find out where they're, if you can increase their near distance. And oftentimes, you can build their near measurement up to like 20 or 30. But it just takes time, because their drive to pull the eyes together at near is so strong. And so, after prolonged occlusion, the book will say like 45 minutes to 60 minutes. I actually will sit in clinic and talk to them while I cover up one eye. And within a minute, you can pull out a lot. And it's usually not that time effective to keep for another 50, 45 minutes. But the OCAS answer is 30 to 60 minutes, you occlude them, and then you see what happens. And then now what are you going to do?
40.
The 40, but it's their ortho near, poor control at distance. You can do surgery for it. Is this the case that you need to do surgery for it now, or could you wait? Or is this kid just in stage two of progressing into an XT? You know, if they're ortho near, I would tend to just watch it, especially at four, because right, this isn't socially, significant yet. Is this divergence, true divergence excess, is like the term that you see in BCSC. It's not that common that you see this, and so you need to be familiar with these terms, but. They're so much less common, I don't want you to get distracted by it. I feel like the BCC is very distracting with these like concepts that are just not that common or relevant. The other thing is, remember how we talked about those stages? Could this be a kid who's just progressing, and then 2 years later they come back with it and then look like that, so. Back on the other side. So Lee, what do you do on this one? He's 10 now. Very good control, though.
There's good control, so the drive to do surgery isn't as high, but I guess they are at an age where there's a social concern, possibly. So who
makes the decision in this case, probably, then?
This would be the parent.
Yeah, exactly right, yeah. Then again, a whole bunch of other entities. Again, these are kind of distracting in these chapters because I feel like as I read this as a resident, like I didn't understand intermittent XT all that well, and then I mean, some of all these other entities, and this is just, again, not that complex, the things that you do see. Perfect. All right. That's it. Thank you, everybody, for coming in. Any questions?